haunts me with each hearing of his softly spoken words. My conscience a reminder of forgiveness that I need. Who is this King of glory who offers it to me? Who is this King of angels? Oh, blessed Prince of Peace. Revealing things of heaven and all its mysteries. Spirits ever longing for his grace and wish to stand. Who is this King of glory, Son of God and Son of Man? His name is Jesus, precious Jesus, the Lord Almighty, King of my heart, King of glory. Is this King of glory with strength and majesty, wisdom beyond measure? Oh, gracious King of kings, the Lord of earth and heaven, the creator of all things. He is the King of glory. He's everything to me. His name is Jesus, precious Jesus, Lord Almighty, the King of my heart, King of glory. Precious Jesus, the Lord Almighty, the King of my heart, King of glory. The creator of all things. He is the King of glory. He's everything to me. His name is
Jesus.
His name is precious
Jesus.
Precious Lord.
Lord Almighty, King of my heart,
King of my heart,
King of glory.
Yeah. Oh, his name is
Jesus,
my precious Lord.
Jesus,
the Lord Almighty, King of my heart, King of glory.
Lord Almighty,
Lord Almighty,
King of my heart,
King of my heart,
King of glory. Amen. Still your mercy.
mercy remains. Should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. Above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself and bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Purpose remains. The art of losing myself and bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Everlasting, my light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul, it cries out. My soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, Lord. My soul, it cries out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to breathe.
thing is another.
My pride for the promise of new life, and I surrender all to you, all to you, and I surrender all to you. All to you. my pride for the promise of new life. And I surrender all to you, all to you. And I surrender all to you, all to you. Singing you this song, waiting at the cross, and all the world knows dear, I count it all as loss for the sake of knowing you, for the glory of your name, to know the lasting joy, even sharing in your pain. And I surrender all to you, all to you. And I surrender all to you, all to you.
I always like coming up here as soon as worship is over and watching all of the kids head out and head to their classes, and they're always going out with excitement, and you know, it's half the adults get up and go too. I don't know why they're leaving, but I won't take it personal. And it's great to know that when the kids walk through those doors, how well they're going to be taken care of. And Rachel and Lisa and all of the volunteers, some of you are in here right now, just do a phenomenal job with our kids every week, and taking care of them and teaching them the Bible and how to be a follower of Christ. And it's just exciting for me to stand here and watch them all head out. And I don't know, some of you may have been keeping track, counting the days. Some of you, time just flies right by. But yesterday, we had been here 1 year. It was 1 year. And what we have, yes, it was also my birthday yesterday. I don't count those years anymore. They're not nearly as much fun as counting ministry years. So, but one of the things we have discovered, and we kind of knew this when we got here, was just how many kids are in this church and how young this church really is. I think someone said the average age in this room is about 40, which is phenomenal to see that. And what that means is not only kids already here, but kids coming, babies coming. And I know a couple weeks ago we dedicated Griffin Bloom, and this morning we get to do that again, not with Griff, but now we get to do it with Naomi. And so I'm going to ask the Hattons, if Brian and Catherine, if they would come, and they're bringing the other girls with them, Natalie and Olivia. And we said last time that this precedent of dedicating children really was set for us many, many, many years ago in the Old Testament, when Hannah brought her son Samuel and presented him to the Lord after waiting so long to have a child. And so it's always exciting for us to be able to dedicate children. And Brian and Catherine are part of our small group, so we get to see these three wonderful young ladies every week. And it's always a guess whether the little one will actually come to me when the time comes or not. So I usually try to play with them on Friday nights just to get amused, but we'll see. So let me just ask you these simple questions. Brian and Catherine, in bringing Naomi here, is it your desire you're going to commit to raising her in a Christ-centered home, to keep Christ in the middle of your relationship and in your home, to teach her the truths of God's Word and Scripture, to teach her the love for the Bible, to teach her how to play with toes, teach her how to pray, and just love the Lord and be an example to her? Is that what you're committing to today?
Yes.
Yes, very good. Now, church family, we need your help. They can't do this alone. God doesn't expect them to do it alone, which is why he's surrounded them with all of you. So let me ask you, do you, the church family of MAC, promise to be an example to Naomi, whether you're in Sunday school or in the lobby or here, to be an example to her, to encourage her as well to read the Bible and to see what it means to pray, and to be involved in their life as they are raising these three little girls? Will you commit to that this morning?
Yes.
Very good. Okay, here we go. You can come to me. Come on. That's pretty good. In total amazement. So just keep your eye on Dad. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful for the Hattons, and Father, for Brian and Catherine, their desire to bring Naomi and present her to you. Father, a precious treasure, a gift that you have created and given to them. So Father, we just pray that you will bless her life. Father, that she will come to know you at an early age, that she will dedicate her life to you. Father, that she will experience all of the plans that you have for her. And Lord, we just we praise you for this little one and this precious life. Father, help us to be an example to her. Father, that we would not turn her from you, but that we would live our lives in such a way that we would draw her into relationship with you. And we just praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Almost made it. I prayed too long. That's what it was. Thanks, guys. And the fun is, we get to do this again in two more weeks. And that one I know will come to me because he and I headbutt every Friday night and make it a game. So that will be easy. One of the things that I am always asked, it seems, often, not always, but often asked, is, what does a pastor do all week? But we do the rest of, and I always try to, you know, you try to explain how you fill your days and how you fill your hours. And I usually turn back to Peter when Peter said in chapter 6 of Acts, when they needed to select seven Spirit-filled men to kind of serve the widows and the distribution of food and oversee that ministry, that he said that the apostles, it was to free them up so that they could devote themselves to prayer and preaching or teaching. And so Paul told the Ephesians that God gave gifts of pastoring and teaching for the training of the saints in the work of ministry. So my gifts of preaching and teaching give me the responsibility to see to it that this body of Christ, that MAC, is equipped and prepared to do the work of ministry. And so with spiritual gift of leadership, I also have to concern myself with vision and strategy. So a lot of time in my week is spent in that little room, praying, studying, preparing, listening to God to see where we as a body need to go, to see what we as a body need to be involved in, to see where God would do and what God would do with each one of us. With my spiritual gift of leadership, and concerning myself with vision and strategy, I spend a lot of time asking, where is MAC at? Where are we at as a body? Where are we at spiritually as a body? Where are we at as far as in the community as a body? I spent a lot of time this past year investigating and learning the history of MAC, determining where we are as a body. And many times, if I went to lunch with any of you, and usually one or two times a week, I find myself in a restaurant somewhere, sitting down across the table with one of you, and one of the questions I always ask is, why are you here? Why are you at MAC? What is it about this place that keeps you here, that draws you here, that keeps you coming back, that wants you to be involved, that wants you to connect with here? And that is so helpful to understand who we are and where we are. So I'm always evaluating where we are at, asking how we're doing in reaching Delaware County. How are we doing in impacting the Ball State campus? How are we impacting the world through missions? And so a lot of my time is spent in that kind of dreaming, kind of looking out and seeing where we're heading in the future, preparing us to get there. How are the five little words that you see on your bulletin that we've kind of wrapped our minds around and want to use as examples and to show how we're to live? How are those five little words showing themselves in the lives of people? Spending a lot of time seeking the Holy Spirit to lead me as I seek to lead you. When to say yes to things and when to say no. When is God moving and when is God pulling us back? Working with the other staff, trying to help them as much as I can that they can accomplish what God is calling them to do. So I say all of that because it isn't always easy to explain to someone what I do. But let me ask you this. How do you describe what you do all the rest of the week? If someone came up and asked, what do you do? What does your week look like? How easy is it is for you to really sit down and think through, what is it that I really do? How? Why? Because a lot of times we've done it so long it's just become natural. And we just do it. Because this is what we've done. This is how we've done. We know this is what we need to do. And so we do it. But think about, how would you explain to someone what you do for a living? Or if you're retired, what you used to do before you got really busy? My dad worked for the Kmart Corporation for 42 years, and to this day, I don't totally understand what it is he did for 42 years while he was there. I know what he did the first few years he was there, because he moved boxes from trains to trucks and from trucks to trains. I know what he did when he worked on the docks and he loaded boxes onto different vehicles and got them moving across the country. But for the vast majority of his time, I have no idea what my dad did when he went to work every morning. His title was traffic manager for all inbound and outbound logistics. Oh, well, that explains it. And this is what I boiled it down to. That he was in charge of somehow making sure that merchandise got from the suppliers to the warehouse and from the warehouses to the stores. That was it. That was as far as my understanding. How he did that, I don't know. But he worked with a lot of different trucking companies, and all I know is that it usually raked us in about 7 front row seats to Royals games every year. And so, Dad, whatever it is you do, you just keep doing it. But it's not always easy to explain what it is we do. Moms, wow. I looked this one up. Here's a job description for moms, okay? Job description is long-term. Team players needed for challenging permanent work in an often chaotic environment. Candidates must possess excellent communication and organizational skills and be willing to work variable hours, which will include evenings and weekends, and frequently 24-hour shifts on call. Some overnight travel required, including trips to primitive camping sites on rainy weekends and endless sports tournaments in faraway cities. Travel expenses are not reimbursed. Extensive courier duties also required. Other responsibilities include the rest of your life. Must be willing to be hated, at least temporarily, until someone needs 10 bucks. Must be willing to bite tongue repeatedly, also must possess the physical stamina of a pack mule and be able to go from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds flat in case this time the screams from the backyard are not someone just crying wolf. Must be willing to face stimulating technical challenge such as small gadget repair, mysteriously sluggish toilets, and stuck zippers. Must screen phone calls, maintain calendars, coordinate production of multiple homework projects. Must be willing to be indispensable 1 minute and an embarrassment the next. Must handle assembly and product safety testing of 500,000 cheap plastic toys and battery-operated devices. Must also hope for the best but be prepared for the worst. Must assume final, complete accountability for the quality of the end product. Responsibilities also include floor maintenance and janitorial work throughout the facility. Wages and compensation. You pay them. Often frequent raises and bonuses. A balloon payment is due when they turn 18 because the assumption that college will help them become financially independent. When you die, you give them whatever is left. Benefits, while no health or dental insurance, no pension, no tuition reimbursement, no paid holidays, and no stock options are offered there, this job supplies limitless opportunities for personal growth and free hugs for life if you play your cards right. It's not easy to describe what we do. It's not easy to always describe what the Bible is asking us to do. Paul described some job descriptions within the church, and I love the fact that he boiled it down, and he made it as simple as he possibly could. In Romans chapter 12, he said this: servers, serve. Teachers, teach. Encouragers, encourage. Givers, give generously. Leaders, lead diligently. And that, he just kept it as simple as possible. The church is filled with jobs and ministries. The church is filled with opportunities to serve, to lead, to teach, to encourage. Teachers teach, greeters greet, worship leaders worship, ushers ush. Most of these are just simply related to a personal spiritual gift mix and is unique to the individual, but because not everyone should be a teacher. Not everyone should be a greeter. There are some grumpy Christians that we don't want greeting people. That's just the honest truth. But there is one job and description that is required of all Christ followers that applies to every one of us. Jesus called his followers disciples. And so in my understanding, in my simple mind, if greeters greet and teachers teach, then that means that disciples disciple. That's what we're all called to do. That is all of in our job descriptions. As we are disciples, as we are followers of Christ, when Jesus calls us disciples, there comes with that a responsibility and expectation that we are in turn going to be discipling. meaning we're going to be helping other people. We're going to help them grow. We're going to help them understand God's word. We're going to teach other people how to pray. Kind of the same thing that I just charged the Hattons with in raising their daughter, we are all charged with in helping one another develop as followers of Christ. Disciples, disciple. Life with God is oftentimes seen or described as a journey. And we're all on this journey. That God has determined that we are not meant to go it alone. That we are not meant to take on this journey by ourselves. This isn't a solo walk through life. That He has designed the church, united the church, desired for the church to help one another, to be a unified body. Every believer, every follower of Christ, every disciple of Christ has been given, by definition, a responsibility to come alongside one or more other people and help them in their journey, to walk with them, to help them when they stumble to get back up, to help them to keep from stumbling, to strengthen them, to encourage them. Because disciples disciple. They help others grow and mature. Turn with me to Acts chapter 9. Because we have an incredible illustration. And quite frankly, as I'm reading Acts, I have read this book so many times. I've studied this. I took a class on it in Bible college. What I am finding, though, is that as I'm reading through it this time, whole new things pop up to me that I never saw the last 150 times I've read it. That there is this new, whole new experiences that I missed the first times through. And so when Jesus met Paul on that road to Damascus and transformed his life in an instant, that Paul found himself blind and no doubt confused about what had just happened to him. Because here he is on his way to Damascus to destroy the church, to drag Christians out, beat them, send them back to Jerusalem, throw them in prison, and probably eventually kill them. Whether he did it personally or someone, or he stood by and watched it done. That was his job. That was his desire, his purpose in life as he saw it. And Jesus stopped him on the way. And we talked about this a couple weeks ago. That Jesus stopped him on the way and showed him grace. And said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? Why are you doing this? And Paul bowed before him. Paul surrendered his life to him. And so while he found himself blind and confused, his original purpose changed that day. His original outlook on life, his life goals were different. Now he had to go into the city and not destroy Christians, not destroy the church, but he had to go into the city and God said, wait, and I'll let you know what you need to do next. See, Paul had a plan. Paul knew what he was going to do. He had it mapped out. He knew where he was going in different parts of the city and where the Christians lived, and he was going to go there. And now all of a sudden, his encounter with Jesus transformed all that. And now Jesus is in control of his life. And Jesus says, now go on into the city, but you just wait, and I'll let you know what's going to happen next. Paul had to be wondering, am I ever going to get my sight back? Am I going to go into the city and die? What's going to happen to me when I go in? And what we have next in this next section of Scripture in chapter 9, verse 10, what we have is an incredible story of the disciples who disciple. That we have a church who understood what it meant to come alongside and build one another up. A church community, the way it is meant to be. God brought several people into Paul's life in these early stages. People who would come in and help him along with this faith journey, this whole new life that was before him that he didn't understand. And we can learn some things as we look at these men, these disciples who disciple. So turn with me to Acts chapter 9, verse 9. We'll end kind of where we left off a couple weeks ago. It says, for 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision. Ananias, yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. Now, the only way to truly benefit the impact of this story is for the next few minutes you become Ananias. And the Lord has just told you to go to a house that you've never been to before, a house that a guy by the name of Judas owns on State Street, and there's a man by the name of Saul from Tarsus. Okay, you know who that is. You were warned about his coming. And suddenly now God is about to throw you into the pit of lions? What's going through your mind? In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. Lord, Ananias answered, I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name, of which I am one. But the Lord said to Ananias, go. This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Then Ananias went. He went to the house and entered it, placing his hands on Saul. He said, Brother Saul, the Lord, Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Ananias is an incredible example of a disciple who disciples. Because Ananias shows us, teaches us, that disciples who disciple are willing to take risks. We're willing to walk into the lion's den. We're willing to go where God has led us, even though we're not certain of what this outcome is going to be. Well, now we know very little about Ananias. We know he was a believer in Damascus. He knew all about the Saul of Tarsus and his mission to Damascus. Ananias' view of Saul at this point in life would have not been a whole lot different than the Jews' view of Hitler during his tirade, during the Holocaust, during Hitler's desire to eliminate the world of Jews. Paul was on that same path to eliminate the world of Christians. And so when Ananias hears, I want you to go to this house and Hitler's there. And I want you to talk to him. I want you to pray with him. I want you to heal him. Because I've got plans for him. And Ananias, I'm thinking, depending on his personality, says, yeah, I got plans for him too. He tried to offer a reason for not getting involved. He tried to not argue with God, but give and take a little bit. Said, you know who he is. I don't really want to do this. But God said, go. And so he went to the unknown house on Straight Street to meet the man sent to kill the Christians of Damascus. We need to understand that as disciples, we are called to disciple, and that's going to carry with it risks that we have to be willing to take. We have to be willing to go where maybe you don't feel comfortable going. You have to be willing to talk to people that you may not be willing to talk to, comfortable to talk to. Because disciples disciple. It's what we do. It's who we are. Now maybe we aren't placed in a place where we're fearful of life. But you will be sharing yourself. That's what discipling is. It's sharing of ourselves. It's walking our journey with them and coming alongside and sharing our strengths and our weaknesses and joining with another person or with a group of people, joining with another body, the rest of the body, and doing life together. Your life, your struggles, your weaknesses. There's a risk in not always knowing the other person's past. Ananias knew Paul. He knew what Saul's past was. But sometimes we may be asked to come alongside someone we don't know. And the risk is, what life am I stepping into? Because one of the things that we have to understand that I have learned in 27 years of ministry is messy. Discipleship is messy. There's a lot of cleaning up that happens, that has to happen, not only in our own life, but in the lives of those that we come alongside of. And we're going to get messy. And Ananias understood that. He said, you know what? Hey, walking into Paul, I don't know what I'm going to get there. But God said, go and talk to this guy. Lay hands on and pray. And so, you know what? Disciple's disciple, I'm willing to take the risk. I'm willing to trust that God knows what he's doing. And so Ananias went, and Ananias found Paul. And not only did he find him, he accepted him. Can you imagine that? I don't know what transpired in Ananias' mind from walking from his house to Straight Street, but when he got there and he laid eyes on Paul, he called him brother. And that's not a word they used lightly. Brother was, welcome to the family. Brother was part of the community. Brother was someone that I will give my life for. Because no greater love has a man than that he'll lay down his life for a brother. That he'll lay down his life for another person. And when they called each other brothers, when they called each other sisters, that was the connotation behind it. We are one. He welcomed him into this new community of believers, the very community that he was set on destroying, the first or the second person, he came in contact with Judas, I'm sure, but the first person that really reaches out to him welcomes him into this new community. Begins to teach him what this new life with Jesus is all about. Imagine the discussions. As Ananias prays for him and the scales, what's like scales, fall off of Saul's eyes, and he begins to see and he begins to focus again. And he sees this man standing in front of him who he's never met before, who referred to him as brother. Can you imagine the discussion they had as they took a walk through Damascus to the river to baptize Saul? And I'm not even thinking the questions Saul might have had. I'm thinking the questions Ananias had. Tell me again what happened on that road. Tell me again what you heard. Tell me again what you saw. And they began interacting in a new way as brothers would. And imagine the discussion around that table as Saul began to eat for the first time in 3 days. More questions, more answers, more getting to know, more bonding, more community, and a whole lot less risk at this point. I'm sure that Ananias had more questions than Saul did. But Ananias wasn't the only one here that showed us what it means for disciples to disciple. There's another man here, and we have already mentioned him, Judas. We know very little about Judas, almost nothing other than all that Scripture tells us is that he owned a house on Straight Street. But it also tells us that he took Paul in for 3 days. He took Paul in. Now again, Judas, I have to believe he was a believer, because I don't think Jesus would send Paul to a non-believer's house at this stage in the game. And so I have to assume that Judas is a believer. And here, I don't know, maybe Jesus revealed to Judas that I'm sending you Paul of Tarsus is coming to your house. Judas is probably packing up and ready to head out, abandon the place. But he says, no, you're going to take him in. And you're going to care for him. and you're going to meet his needs, and you're going to provide for him, and you're going to come alongside him, and you're going to help him at his greatest point of need. Judas teaches us that discipling one another is going to require not only the risk that Ananias calls for, but the giving of resources. It's going to cost us stuff. It's going to cost us time. It's going to cost us something. Resources that we may have spent on ourselves are now going to be shared with another person or another family. That suddenly my life is no longer my own. My time is no longer my own. That I now have opened myself up to godly interruptions. We call them divine appointments. When God just kind of draws us to another person or brings another person into our life. Sometimes for our benefit, sometimes for the other person's benefit. But we have to begin to wrap our minds around this idea that because I am a disciple, I disciple. And that means that I'm wide open for at any moment. Judas wasn't planning on this. He was not prepared for house guests, much less the one he was getting. I wonder if he locked his doors at night. You know, bedroom door, locked it, moved the dresser in front of it, just in case. Because this mass murderer, this terrorist to Christians, this destroyer of the faith, was moving into his house. I don't know if he knew it was just 3 days, but we know on this side. That is why we have that fifth little word on the bulletin. The five little words. That fifth word is stewarding our lives. We have to steward our lives. We have to cut in and allow time for God to interrupt, to allow time for us to draw alongside other people, to have other people draw alongside us. We have to make time, intentionally make time for community, or it'll never happen. Community doesn't happen by accident. It's intentional. It's intentional to pull alongside someone. It's intentional to have them pull alongside you. And that's the way God designed it. And so we have to steward our lives to make sure that we have time for that. We have to steward our resources to make sure that we have money, that we have resources, that we have availability to meet the needs when they come along. There was going to be some cost involved in having Saul move in for 3 days. Now, Judas may have said, at least he's not eating. But we have to be prepared. We have to be ready. And if we are disciples of Christ, then we have to be ready to disciple. And that means taking risks. And that means using our resources for the benefit of other people. Judas gave 3 days of his time. He gave his house. Eventually, he gave his food. You know, more than once, Sarah and I have taken vacations with those that we are discipling. We take a week's vacation. We get so many a year. We take a week's vacation, and we go. Most of the time, we wound up in Colorado with, we call them friends, but really, they were people we were pouring our lives into. People in our small group, people in our church. That we had committed to doing life together. Now, we could have gone by ourselves. It might have even been more enjoyable. But disciples disciple. And that's a 24/7, 365 job. You're never off the clock as a disciple. You're always pouring into someone or having someone pour into you, or at least that's the way we need to start looking at life. Disciples, disciple. It's what we do. Now, an interesting thing occurs at this part of our story. Because Luke doesn't share everything that Paul shares when Paul tells this story. Paul is writing to the Galatians, and he is reiterating what happened to him along the road to Damascus. And he's telling them about you know, being blind and coming back and then what happened next. And he puts a very important part of this story into it that Luke leaves out for whatever reason. Galatians chapter 1, Paul says, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, this is to the Galatians, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. Now, most of us would stop there and say, okay, well, that's the on the road to Damascus, Jesus revealed himself, and then Paul understood, and he went in, and from Luke's story, we see that, you know, immediately he begins walking, leaves the house on Straight Street the next morning after a great meal, and he gets out and he starts preaching on the street corners. That's how we read it in Acts. But Paul says, no, wait a minute, something else happened. I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ, for you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being. I did not go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was, but I went into Arabia, and later I returned to Damascus. After verse 19, before verse 20, when he says that he was preaching in the streets of Damascus, Paul spent time in Arabia. He left the house on Straight Street. I knew at some point I was not going to get that out right. He left the house on Straight Street, and he went not to the streets of Damascus to begin preaching this new revelation. He went to the Arabian desert to receive the revelation. He went to the Arabian desert to meet with Jesus. Jesus led him out there, and Jesus began preaching to him and teaching him. Jesus began discipling him. He says in verse 18, then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Cephas, or Peter, and stayed with him 15 days. I saw none of the other apostles, only James, the Lord's brother. I assure you before God that what I am writing you is no lie. We're in a journey, and we're in a process. Saul, after being baptized and regaining his strength, tells us that he went into the Arabian desert where Jesus revealed the gospel to him in full. This is what enables us to even consider Paul an apostle. He was an eyewitness of Jesus. He learned from Jesus, just like the other 12 had, just like the other apostles had, that they were set apart by Christ, that Saul was now being set apart, that he was one who Jesus had personally discipled. And after sitting under Jesus' direct teaching for approximately 3 years in the desert. We don't know exactly how long he was in the desert, but it could have been up to 3 years because it says he spent a few days in Damascus before he returned to Jerusalem. And so for 3 years, he's in the desert, receiving from Jesus all the things that the other apostles received for 3 years on earth, roaming with Jesus. And after sitting under Jesus' teaching, it says Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus, Acts 9:19. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God, that all those who heard him were astonished and asked, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priest? Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah. Discipleship is important to our growth. Ananias proves that fact, shows us. Judas shows that. Paul's life, 3 years in the desert with Jesus, shows that discipleship, personal growth, is important. That it is our ability to witness to others, our ability to impact the world around us, to positively impact the world with the gospel, is dependent upon our discipleship, our being discipled. And so if we are disciples, we have to be discipling others, because our ability to change this world is dependent upon it. Jesus wasn't just joking when he said, go and make disciples. How do you make disciples? You disciple. You train them up. You come alongside. You teach them. That's what Jesus did to Paul for 3 years in the desert. Came alongside. And discipleship is intentional on both sides of the equation. Jesus wanted to teach Saul, and Saul wanted to know him more. He wanted to know Christ crucified. He wanted to know more than anything else what it was to be in relationship with Jesus. That was his goal. His lifelong desire was to just know Christ and know the extent of his life and to know his crucifixion, to know his resurrection, and to one day, in hopes of joining him in that. We can read Acts 9 and think that Saul was just miraculously led by the Spirit and began preaching in Damascus. But he only miraculously started preaching in Damascus after 3 years in the desert with Jesus. That there was a training ground, a proving ground, that we want to think that he left that little house and began preaching on every street and was able to preach with incredible authority and astonish people, but that ability only came after spending so much time with Christ. Jesus knows discipleship is important to our growth, to our maturity, to our ability to be effective ministers to others, to our ability to impact this world, that disciples who disciple is the key to evangelism in reaching this community. That it is our ability to disciple one another that is going to be the biggest evangelistic tool. We have to understand that. Listen to what Jesus says. This is the very thing that Jesus prayed for in the garden right before being crucified. He said, "My prayer is not just for them alone," otherwise the 12 disciples. He says, "I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message," that's us, "that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me." It is this act of discipleship, this coming together, this unifying, this coming alongside, this helping one another, this doing life together, that is the biggest evangelistic message of the gospel out there. In a world that is isolated, in a world that says me first, me only, me all the time, to watch a community come together, to look on the outside and watch people help one another, help people grow one another, share their resources, take risks, be involved, share all things in common, Acts 2:42 and Acts 4. To show that just being the church, just disciples who disciple, shares the gospel. And it begins with us. When the church unites, when we intentionally begin to act and think as one, when we begin to love one another, when we begin to take risks with one another, when we begin to share resources with one another, the world sees the gospel in action. Many times they don't need to hear it. They just need to see it. Discipleship is at the center of Jesus' heart. Disciples who disciple is the heartbeat of the church. And Jesus set us the example. Mark tells us that when Jesus chose the 12, he went up on the mountain and he prayed all night long. Out of all the disciples that were following him, all of the followers, all of the people that were chasing after Jesus, Jesus said, "Lord, give me some." I don't know if he probably did know it was 12 because he's Jesus. But he didn't know which 12. And he prayed all night, "Lord, which ones?" And one by one, God began to reveal to him the ones that he wanted Jesus to pour himself specifically into. That those 12 would then become the ones who would pour themselves into others. Who would then pour themselves into others. And Mark chapter, or Mark tells us when he chose the 12 that he chose them to be with him. That's a huge phrase that we oftentimes overlook. That Jesus chose those 12 men to be with him, to come alongside and watch his life, inspect his life, to do life together. That the only time we see Jesus alone is when he went off to a solitary place to pray. The only time we see Jesus by himself is when he was one-on-one with the Father. The rest of the time, he was with the 12, or at least part of them, growing them, preparing them, maturing them. And when Jesus chose Saul, he spent time with him in the desert, growing him, preparing him, maturing him. God had an incredible plan for Saul's life. And getting it started right required more than just time with Jesus. Jesus used other disciples as well to build Saul up. Saul right away experienced the benefit of disciples who disciple, and later instructed that the young pastor Timothy, who Saul came alongside of, that when he was Paul came alongside Timothy. And he tells Timothy this. He says, Timothy, pass on what you have learned from me to reliable men who would in turn be able to teach others. So what Paul got from Jesus, Paul passed on to Timothy, and he tells Timothy to pass it on to other men so that other men can pass it on to other men so that other men can pass it on to other men, and that cycle never stops. That's disciples who disciple. If we decide we're not going to disciple, then pass it on to other men who are able to nothing. If you just take the knowledge and you don't do anything with it, if we cease to disciple, if we cease to train up, if we cease to come alongside, what good is it? And Paul wanted to make sure Timothy understood. Take what I've given you and pass it on to reliable men who will be able to teach others. And keep that going. The Christian Missionary Alliance has long used the phrase, disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make... And that is who we are. That is what we do. Who is your Ananias? Who is the one that came alongside you and began to pour into you this Christ-like life, to build you up, to encourage you? The big question today is, who are you Judas to? Who are you, the one that will come alongside and take time and resources and pull alongside someone just to help them get a good start, just to help them learn, just to help them mature? See, this is the normal pattern of a healthy church. Disciples who disciple, who disciple, who disciple. Mac is committed to enabling these relationships. We're committed to fostering these relationships, these disciples who disciple, and that's why we are built on small groups. That we are specifically designed to foster these relationships. And here's one thing I have learned in the last year that I have been here. You may not believe me in this, but I've been in enough churches to know that this is true. Most of you are farther along the discipleship journey than you think you are. Most of you are able to come alongside and begin to disciple when maybe you don't feel like you can. I don't know enough. You know more than some. Pull alongside those some and share with them what you do know. And find that other person that will pull alongside you and teach you more. And pour more life into you that you can pour more life into them. And I guarantee you that some of you are farther along that journey than you think you are. You are ready to step in and be a disciple who disciples, who disciples, who disciples. You just have never taken the risk. You've never stepped out. This morning it's a call to step out. It's a call to take that risk. to find that person that you can pull alongside, or to seek out that person that needs to pull alongside you. There are Ananiases here who will take the risk of this new responsibility, who will foster these new relationships. There are Judases here who will open up their homes and spend time with a group of people, just encouraging one another and praying together with one another and doing life together. And as we begin to foster these relationships, we will make a difference. Because Jesus said it's those relationships that are going to impact the world. We can impact this community. We can impact this campus. We can make this impact reach around the world. But we are going to have to step up and become disciples who disciple. Let's pray. Father, this morning you have given us a huge task. And many of us may very well feel like Ananias, that I can't do this. But Lord, you will enable, you will empower. I pray for your Holy Spirit to empower the minds of those that need to step up into this discipleship role of being the one that comes alongside. Father, they would seek out those that you, like Jesus praying, give me 12 men. Father, lay it upon our hearts to truly be disciples and disciple others. Father, that we might grow up, that we might mature, and that in so doing, we might have an incredible impact on this community around us. Father, do your work that only you can do in our midst this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand? We're going to redo the first song that we did opening this morning, because the song is about those opportunities that we've missed, maybe reaching out to somebody, discipling somebody, as Ted said. So this is, especially the chorus in here, really want to focus on just making that choice to step forward and doing as God calls and what Jesus would want us to do. So sing along with me.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure, and I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life, and I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Light unto the world, light unto my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find. All I need is you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom. soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow where you go. I'll go where you stay. I'll stay when you move. I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. Who you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Who you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
Thank you.
me standing up here and telling you what you need to do. But my job's not over, and your job's not over. Because it would be easy for me to just say, go do this. But if you remember, I started at the beginning that part of my job is to equip you to do acts of service, to do ministry. And so if you're interested in stepping up and taking risks and sharing resources and what that means, how can I disciple? I want to talk to you. I want to meet with you, and there's probably a group of you that we can begin that process of training, of coaching, of mentoring, of me discipling, coming alongside you. Because Paul says this, as a prisoner for the Lord, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head. That is Christ. For him, from him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. That's an incredible system. That's an incredible process. And we're all a part of it. And if you want to get more involved in it, you see me. Because I want to help equip you. I want to help prepare you to go out and impact the world. Amen? Amen. Have a great week.
I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song to the Lord.
Totally muted us, right?